Welcome back, Naruto Anime Review. This is part 11. And in this season, we're going to talk about season 19 and the long season 20. Yeah. And there's a lot to talk about when it comes to two seasons. Like I said with the previous video, season 19 is another filler season. Yeah, it starts out with how the last season ended with Naruto clinging to life while Sakura is trying to resuscitate him. And then we decided to flashback to prior to the start of the Shippuden show, where it pretty much is just an explanation of how the heck that the characters got their promotions to their current ranks, where most of the characters got promoted to Chunin, and Neji, how Neji got promoted to Jonin. That's simply to put what season 19 is. And so pretty much Team Guy definitely does sign up for this, and Team 8 does too. But when it comes to Team 10, they decided to do something quickly unique because Shikamaru has already been promoted to the Chunin. He doesn't have to participate in the Chunin exams. So Team 10 is like, okay, we need a third member. Why not Sakura? Which, okay, that's not a bad idea per se, especially since Team 7 has mostly been disbanded. Well, because Sasuke is off with Orochimaru and Naruto is training with Jiraiya. And so they ask her to join the team because they brought back the Chunin exams. So basically the way the Chunin exams work this time is the fact that it's hosted jointly by the Leaf and Sand Village, where the first round is held in the Leaf Village and the second round is held in the Sand Village. Yep, so Sakura does join the team after some convincing, and of course after she barely survives surgery. After she barely survives performing surgery, she does participate in the Chunin exams. So, it's not a bad idea to do, have Sakura, because, well, with her teammates gone doing whatever, and they need the... It probably would have been a bad idea for have her not be promoted to the Chunin, which, okay, fine. So, she joins the team, and Team 10 pretty much is, at this point, just Choji, Ino, and Sakura. Not a bad combo. And of course, Ino and Sakura have gotten over their animosity toward each other over their affections towards Sasuke. Though Ino basically still kind of has a thing for Sasuke, but not as much as Sakura does. So they sign up for the exam. Now here's the thing about the proctors of the exams. The first round is not done by the interrogator that was shown in the first season of Naruto. This time it's Shikamaru and Tamaru who are the proctors of the first exam of the first round, and stuff is done differently. Of course, prior to all the Chunin exams officially starting, they have it where Tsunade sends invitations to all the villages. Well, of course, San obviously sends their shinobi anyways, but everybody turns them down except for two villages. Because everyone else turns them down because they're basically dealing with their own internal matters, so they can't exactly send anybody. So the only two villages who actually send anybody is the Hidden Rain Village, which at this point is under the control of Pain. Though the outside world, they still think it's Hanzo the Salamander who's controlling the Rain Village, who sent a few getting out for participating in Chunin exams. The Waterfall Village only sends one team, consisting of their Jirojiki, Fu, who basically wants to join the Chunin exam so she can have friends, and a couple people to keep an eye on her. Yeah, and she wants to fight. Okay, fine. It's later revealed that she's actually a Jonin. Her and her comrades are actually Jonin. Yeah, it's really bizarre, and I keep thinking, though, why doesn't Gaara disqualify her because she's not a genin? But, nope. She does not get disqualified for it after he finds out about it. And the first round is quite differently how it was done in the original series. This time, it's basically, because there's so many participants, instead of holding in one classroom this time, they decided to hold it in three classrooms on three floors, and the teams are split up between the floors. One room has Neji and Hinata in there. So they have it where cheating is actually allowed, It's just that certain teams have to survive it. So the way that they do it is that either they yell at the seating if they don't have a special jutsu, like telekinesis type of thing. So Ino pretty much uses her mind transfer jutsu to give them the proper answers. And get this, instead of having 10 questions this time, there are only 3. And everybody is basically just doing their best, and and it's really weird. Apparently one answer is 30 points, another answer is 70, 40, and the one's like 50. Okay. A bit odd, though. It depends upon the actual team, per se, on how exactly this... As long as the thing equals 100 points, they will be fine. That is simply how the thing works. So, yeah. And all the Leaf Village Genny basically all survived this, along with a few other teams. And of course, Shikamaru takes down notes of how good Neji is doing during the whole thing. Despite the fact they're also banging on the walls to get the proper answer to the questions. Yeah, it's an interesting idea. So, and of course, since they had particular teams, one team basically... Then they came up with this really strange thing for the third question where one of whom has to leave one of their teammates behind. One team does do this, the rest of them don't. So nobody gets sacrificed because they think it's a really dumb idea to do. So any team does not have 3 members, they get automatically disqualified. And then, of course, they decide to just run to the hidden the second round is happening in the Sand Village. So not directly in the Sand Village, per se. It's held in one of their training grounds, the Demon Desert, because the forest of it's too familiar to them. That's simply the reason for it. Because originally it was just the Hidden Leaf Village sponsoring it, while the Sand Village helps out, but to some convincing, they pretty much jointly run it. Okay, and though Gaara tries to insinuate that it's just the sand just has a proctor for the second round, though they kind of basically send out their own. Also, for some reason, Kakashi is not participating. He's in the season. He's actually not participating, I think. Basically, it's just because Team 7 is not around. Basically, Kakashi just jack squat this season. So it's just, for the senseis, it's just Guy, Ashima, and Koronai basically go out with the other Genny to participate in the actual tuning exams. So they all just run to the Demon Desert terrain. And here's the thing. At this point in time, from this point up until the last episode, that's where the season takes place. In this second round, and pretty much in the same thing, getting these Heaven and Earth Scrolls. And they have to basically cooperate with each other. Now, here's the weird thing. It doesn't... And pretty much the whole point is to get 2 scrolls. Get an Earth Scroll and Heaven Scroll. And they pretty much... Now, they can either take them from the same village or either a different village or the same village. It doesn't really matter. There's a couple of sand village people really interesting. One is led by a student of... and both these two teams have Gaara students in. One where he's kind of like... who's kind of like Lee, where he doesn't know any jutsu or genjutsu, just knows taijutsu. And it's shown in the flashback that he basically, while he was practicing taijutsu, basically also building up his muscles as well, he basically smashed the boulder. Gaara was not happy with the smashed boulder, but he accepted him as a student, while teaching him a little more of taijutsu. And of course, Mizumi is also on one of the teams as well with her friend. Yeah. And also, the guy who knows taijutsu has got 2 women on his team. One of whom has a thing for him. And she looks like a little girl. I am not kidding. If you see this girl, you're like, okay, how old is this girl supposed to be? She looks like she's about 13 or 14. He looks like he's about pushing 20. Yeah, it's a really bizarre thing. Though they have this weird thing also where certain characters can look older than they actually are. So, yeah. And he says this was going to be his last mission before he goes out on the border. He goes on permanent border patrol. And, of course, the girl goes with him at the end of the season. And also, while all this is going on, apparently someone is planning a coup d'etat trying to kill Gaara, because apparently some people in the Sand Village don't trust him. The youth trust him, but some of the more older people do not trust Gaara at all, despite the fact they're the ones named Kazekage. So, yeah. Also, when they're at that place, when they get there, when they get to the place where they stay the night before they actually go out in the desert itself, before they get started with their food, there's this really, really big overweight guy who someone referred to as a larger version of Choji. And seriously, if you see this guy, you're like, okay, yeah, this guy is seriously a much bigger version of Choji, where he's like it's much more weight to this guy, and there's a bunch of sweat going off him when he's eating. Like, this guy is so disgusting. And they didn't want him dropping his sweat on the food, but inadvertently they started a fight, and pretty much most of them don't eat dinner anyways. And Fu, who wants to go out and meet people, basically the two people she comes with traps her in a room, so the only way she can get out of the room is by breaking a window. And her breaking another window is how she stops the fight. And she doesn't want to make friends. So, and of course, later on, Choji, who is really hungry, he wants to go over to where the adults are trying to get some food. And because there's a sandstorm, apparently, and because they're getting not supposed to be out beyond curfew, they inadvertently run into a giant scorpion who is easily defeated. Well, and of course, this is one of two giant scorpions seen this season. And this one, Fu defeats this one very simply without being afraid, while everybody else is trying to get away from it. And Gaara and Guy and Ashima and Koronai is like, what's going on here? And Choji's like, I'm hungry. I just was so hungry. And Guy gives him some sandwiches to calm him down. Which, okay, I gotta praise Guy for bringing sandwiches, because he probably knew the fact that Choji, Choji might get hungry, because he has a tendency to, if he doesn't eat, his stomach gets a, he only has food on his mind. Gaara is basically questioning about Fu, he's curious about her, but he's not, interested in her romantically, just interested in her, basically, her power. And, of course, then they get to the actual desert terrain, and pretty much you have people fighting. And also you have it's where Team Guy meets up with three people from the Hidden Rain Village, which is the team of all women. And you also get to see, it's like you have certain episodes to focus on the three teams. Like you have two or three episodes either focused on Team Guy, Team Ashima, or Team Koronai. And they usually take about two or three episodes just to focus on them in a way. Excuse me. And one team, well, Kiba's thinking of Naruto when he was training. Though Naruto himself has seen a few times when he is training with Jiraiya. And I think that Naruto's inspiration to actually go forward. And of course, Sakura and the other scorpion, Sakura basically crushed that one, no problem. And of course, the other team they ran into, basically, one of them knows medical jutsu. Yeah, and when it comes to Team Guy, when they run into the people from the Hidden Rain Village, and of course sees himself with Ten-Ten, sees him flashbacks with her. Now, whenever I see flashbacks of Ten-Ten, it usually is pretty interesting. I usually like Ten-Ten's flashbacks, because you don't get a chance to see much of her on the show, so why not show some of her backstory in flashbacks? Yep. They also did this also in Season 9, where they explained that she wanted to be like Tsunade. And she had a special ability to summon. She had, she had the ability to summon tools out of the scrolls, and she was actually very good at it. So, she works, and of course, the Rain Village basically, the people basically, they decided not to fight until they get their teammates back, and they agree that they should not be fighting. They actually look for their teammates. So they go on its roots, and Ten-Ten and the one girl from the Rain Village, and they talk for a bit, and talk about basically seeing the Angel Lady, who is Coney, one of Jiraiya's students. And they walk for a while, and they run into these, basically these giant ants. I am not kidding. These ants are the size of cars. And they run into, like, a small colony of them. And, of course, they also run into a dead end. And while the other one's using cards to sort of basically move all this stuff, Tintin's like, okay, like, can you try to move that stuff? So he basically opens up a scroll, and it's an ocean, and it blows right through the block entranceway, and everybody gets out of there, and they agree that because they're exhausted while looking for them, they decided not to fight. So, yeah, that's not bad for them to do. And, of course, there's another episode where thinking that, oh, she's just a reliable tool because she summoned stuff completely when they needed. That's, of course, prior to this one. It's always nice to see Tintin do stuff. There was one flashback I saw where, because Guy lost the bet basically because Tintin beat him in battle, he had to basically walk on his hands around the village with Tintin on top of him. Well, Tintin on the bottom of his feet, and while he's walking on his hands. I thought that was kind of funny. And there was another one that showed this season of her trying to seal part of the ocean inside of one of her scrolls. Yeah. Basically, a lot of these characters get a lot of character development, and the people who are trying to overthrow Gaara basically has this one guy who plays a guitar and has sort of a sealing jutsu who tries to remove Shikaku from Gaara's body. Fu tries to help him. Fu first helps help Mizumi's team save him from a whirlpool, which Gaara was a little bit surprised to see her do this. But he's happy that he saved Mizumi. She saved Mizumi, so she owes him a favor. He owes her a favor for doing that. Yeah. And then, of course, later on, she tries to help him because they're fellow Jiraiya. And, of course, Gaara gets basically the chain thing put into his gut. She gets it in her back, in her lower back. And Mizumi basically, she's the one who basically got Fu to help him. And the other two, actually, it wasn't Mizumi. It was Mizumi who got Team Guy to help. So they pretty much agreed that, because they really want to help Gaara. So Neji's the one who basically free, and Fu decides to form a temporary cocoon to slow, even though that it won't stop the removing thing, it will slow it down. And Gaara, even though this is kind of dumb for her to do, but yeah. So the way Neji gets inside of this thing is that he uses a chakra sword. He has Tintin for a chakra sword to cut through the cocoon. And he figures out the way to break out the chains. Basically, he uses a chakra needle thing to basically fix the problem. First, he does it to Gaara. Then he does it to Fu. And this is actually the reason why he gets promoted to Jonin later on. And because all that's happened, they decided to cancel the third round because they don't think it's really necessary, and he gives off recommendations to the fellow villages. While in the case of the lead village, it's not shown what happened to the Sand Shinobi. Well, Mizumi's team is not shown what happened to them, but it's implied they probably got promoted to the Chonin anyways. The other team, two of them get sent to the border. Well, the other one, basically, even though it's stated that, yeah, she has a thing for him. She decided to go with him, and the other one just does whatever. So all the Leaf Genin go back to the Leaf Village, and pretty much almost all of them, except for four of them, get promoted to Chonin. The three of the four who didn't, Tsunade's like, try again next time. Like, okay. And while Team Guy, while Tintin and Rock Lee gets promoted to Chonin, because of, and Neji does not get promoted to Chonin. He gets promoted, right, to Jonin. So, excuse me. Yeah, so he gets promoted, and it was Gaara's special recommendation that he gets promoted to Jonin. And what happened to the Rain Village people? Well, they all get promoted to Chonin. because of Garrett's recommendation of how good they did. And then, of course, the one who worked with Ten-Ten when she was down in those ruins, she gets indirectly, she and the other woman get killed, and they become one of the Pillars of Pain. And what about Fu? Fu meets up with Hazan, his string partner. And apparently Fu knows him, even though he has never seen him before. And she's like, oh, I want to be your friend. And he's like, I didn't come be your friend. And that's the last time we see her, because next time we see her, of course, we saw in the previous season where she is basically under brain damage, Yuzu, which means that her Lucky Seven tail thing, I don't remember his name, gets removed and she dies. Yep. So, season 19 was a pretty interesting season nonetheless. I didn't think at this point it was necessary. I think the best idea for it is probably save for a little bit later. But I guess they probably felt as though they probably needed to do it. Because I guess some people were asking the animation team, like, how the heck did these characters get their promotions? Yeah, what did they do? Did they have an around tuning exam or something? And yeah, I guess season 19 answers a question that some people may have asked, but not a lot of people. And of course, now we get to season 20. The season that is really long, and when I was watching, it took me almost 4 days to watch it because of how long it was. Yeah. Of course, we started the season with where we ended off with season 18. With Naruto clinging to life, so, of course, Mendo decides to successfully transfer the other half of Kurama, despite the fact the Black Zazu tries to stop him, but he succeeds. And yeah, they try to stop him, but he does succeed in giving him light later on. But of course, with everybody there, with everybody all that's going on, and it's later revealed. Let's see. What else? Let's see here. Yeah, and while Obito basically just tries to, and of course they have a flashback episode of Obito reminiscing about the early days with Team Mento, and of course, when Obito gets turned on by Mandara and gets the Ten Tails into him, basically forming his own version of the Six Age of Paths. And of course, the Six Age of Paths makes his own appearance in this season, gives Sasuke and Naruto their own special power, and he reveals that they're actually the current reincarnation of his sons. Yeah. And of course, in this season, we get a couple explanations of what happened, or the backstory of the Sage Six Paths mother in one episode, and of course shows him, how he became it, and then of course we also have another set of filler episodes of what was going on with sons, and the Black Sabbath manipulating one of them, who later became the founder of the Uchiha clan. What else? Also Infinite Tazumi, that gets activated, and it stays activated for pretty much the rest of the season. And everybody except for the four Hokage, Obito, who is basically under possession of the Black Zatsu, who really wants to get Obito's Rasengan Eye, though eventually, I think Mandara also steals Kakashi's eye, steals a Sharingan eye. While the Jutsu is activated, the only people who are not affected, like I said, are the four Hokage, Black Zetsu, who's possessing Obito, and Team 7. They're the only ones completely affected by it. And while everybody is just under the Jutsu, you get a chance to see some of them basically what they do. There's even a two-parter called Road to Ten-Ten. Basically, where it shows, like, what if Ten-Ten went to the world that Naruto and Sakura went to in the movie Road to Ninja. where everybody pretty much kind of acts the same they did in the film, though slight differences. Like how Naruto is definitely called Menma, and where his hair is the exact duplicate of his father's hair. And it's pretty much the same world, just some slight differences. Also, Sasuke throws a flower at Sakura, and both, and this is a weird thing, both Sakura and Hinata are basically just on Menma's arms and acting like, how should I put this? They're just drooling all over him. It's like they really want him. And they even try to fight each other over him. And now they pretty much act the same way she did in the film, basically a complete slut. Well, Sakura pretty much act the same way, despite Sasuke also wanted to do her. He also wants her as well. And Tenten wants to undo the jutsu, but she's having trouble with it. And of course, Neji, because this is pretty much the same type of the same Neji from the Road Ninja film, decides he's to be Akagon to be a pervert and sees that Tenten does not wear underwear. I'm like, really? She doesn't wear underwear. And she also tries to talk to Koronai to break the jutsu. That doesn't go any place. She's actually a little bit afraid. She doesn't want to talk. She basically refuses to break the jutsu for some reason. It's a very weird two-parter per se, but it's pretty decent for what it is. Then came right after that. Of course, we also have a two-parter with Killer B, him forming his own team of Jurijiki. And here's the thing. The tail beasts are small, really small. Apparently, they're not inside their bodies. They're actually on their shoulders. Excuse me. So they go around. So basically, Killer B wants to recruit all of his fellow Jurijiki to protect the princess from the Akatsuki. Yeah, and he frees them. And some of them are kept in the weirdest places. Like, Gar is kept in that place where the priest was showing a flashback in the previous season. Naruto, I was surprised where the heck he was kept. He was kept in Tsunade's head in the Hokage Mount for some reasons. Never explained why. Oh, and Tsunade is still a gambler. Not kidding. And Gaara cheats to get out of the place. And also, for some weird reason, Killer B cannot stop to stare at Tsunade's chest. For some reason. I have no idea why. And of course, they free everybody. And he frees everybody. And Naruto calls Yakyo, I think that's how you pronounce her name. She's the host of Two-Tailed Cat. Calls her Auntie. And he's like, Auntie? He's like, she's getting very angry. Okay, sister. Okay, fine. Because she's slightly older than Naruto. I just thought that was so funny. But they do win in the end. But it's a nice little two-parter. But after that comes the 19-episode arc. I'm not kidding. 19 episodes called The Scrolls, The Jiraiya Scrolls. Where it's an alternate take on part 1 and part 2. And it's told from Tsunade's perspective. It basically, and so of course Tsunade is basically spending the whole 19 episodes reading this. Though for some reason the finale, she's in the Hokage room, instead of being in this gazebo. And how this world is slightly different is that, one, Naruto's parents are alive, and of course Naruto's father is still Hokage. The half of Kurama's chakra did not go inside of Minto, went inside of Naruto's mother instead. The Uchiha clan massacre never happened this reality. Never. And pretty much, they go on like, they show like one mission of all 12 Genin, and apparently it's under some experiment. It's some test that Neji's father on the reanimation jutsu put the test on everybody, and he hired the Akatsuki, and some of the Akatsukiers, I'm like, what the heck are they doing here? And when they show Yano, Nagato, and Kinin, they're pretty much wearing their the first version of the Akatsuki attire, and they refer to themselves as Team Jiraiya. Yeah, because they're Jiraiya students. And of course, you also get a chance to see Naruto no Rasengan, You can see that too. The village, they basically help save from a big battle that gets destroyed by Deidara. Though Nagato does not know that. They think it's the Hidden Leaf Village who did it. And Sasori is the one who told them. Yep, Sasori. And the mission they were sent on was to rescue some Jonin, which had been kidnapped. And it's kind of like they were rushing through what is... It's kind of basically using elements of the regular Part 1 and Part 2. Basically the first two shows and just combine them to one. And basically when they end the first fight, it's kind of slightly different than how it ends at the end of the original show, where Jiraiya goes off the train with Naruto. And Sasuke decides to join decides he wants to join the... Because he doesn't want to deal with Naruto much anymore. So he decides to train with somebody from the elite police force. And he goes off for 3 years. And they come back. And, of course, they both come back. Of course, everybody's wearing... Well, Naruto's wearing his Part 2 attire. While everybody else is pretty much a brother of the Choni. So they all wear their battle vest. Despite the fact, in the regular reality, they never actually did that. And Sasuke is on the police force. And he's a lieutenant. And he apparently is abusing his power. Simply put, it's the same antagonism that the police force in regular reality have been doing prior to them being exterminated during... prior to them being taken out during the Chan Clan massacre. And there's also at one point, because Naruto stopped them from arresting a woman who apparently... she did not get the permission to reopen up her shop for some reason. I have no idea why. So, because Sasuke is like, okay, do whatever the heck you want. Don't ask me for, don't listen to me. Don't come to me if you're in trouble. So they decided to do something really stupid. The guys who basically were his squad, they decided to break into the fourth Hokage's house to try to arrest Naruto for preventing their thing. And they get a confrontation with Naruto's mother, which he gets very upset about that. And pretty much has an... apparently, it's implied they have an off-screen fight with him. And then, of course, these guys get arrested. And basically, they get the same beating that they gave the criminals. That is shown prior to this, that where they get that. And they... and, of course, because of all the abuse, Sasuke gets fired from the police force. And he's like, oh, I need more power. So Danzo talks to him. Of course, they've seen Danzo early on. I really don't care for Danzo. So he convinced him to go see Orochimaru. And, of course, Naruto finds out that he needs... Orochimaru wants to see him. Orochimaru wants Sasuke to be his next vessel. For some reason. I don't know why. Yeah. And so Naruto... Yeah, I think it's Naruto, Sasuke, not Sasuke, trying to think, what else is there? Let's see here. Let's see. Let's see, who goes with Naruto? Oh, it's a team guy goes with him as well. But there's one thing I forgot to talk about, and that's the massive battle between... there's a couple of things I forgot to talk before I continue with this part. Guy fighting Mandara Chia. And he activates the 8 Inner Gates. He nearly dies, but thanks to Naruto, he managed to survive. And, of course, Naruto battles him as well. And this is, of course, before the Eren Mission Jutsu. Let's see. Oh, yeah. There's even a two-parter that kind of explains, what Konohamaru was up to during most of the series prior to this point, like, up until the Pain Attack. And, of course, it showed that Naruto teaches him Rasengan, and it shows, like, all that. It's like, what the heck he was up to during the first 8 seasons. Yeah, it simply put what it is, like I said. It's what Konohamaru was up to during the first 8 seasons, what he was... Yeah. It's basically the stuff that was taught off. It's the stuff that was done off screen, told in this two-parter. And because Naruto's apartment was destroyed during the paint attack, Konohamaru kept some of his old stuff, including his jacket. Yep. So it's interesting little two-parter. Now back to the Jiraiya scroll. So they go out, and of course they, because the whole place is on lockdown because Sasuke left the village. So the Leaf 11 decided to sort of sneak out of the village, have Naruto and Chikahamaru sneak out of the village by using a hole that Kiba uses to get out of the village. So they go down, and Neji knows someone following them. And of course, it's four people, well, five people actually, who tries to stop them. And I know who these four people are. When I saw them, I'm like, really? So, okay. Apparently, the four people that Danzo sent to try to stop Naruto and Shikamaru and Team Guy from getting to Sasuke, it's Anko, the proctor of the second exam, the second round of the shooting exams. The first guy Hansen, I think his name is. He was the guy who was the first proctor of the third exam. His lover, Sai, and Yamato. That's who we sent after them. And of course, Anko does something that she did in the manga, but she never did in the show: lick Naruto's cheek. Because he got close to her, and of course he removed her mask. Like, when I saw her stockings, when I saw her little name thing stocking, I'm thinking, she looks familiar. And then Naruto took her mask, it's Anko. And of course he gets ticked up because he gets his face licked. Which I thought that was so funny. And, of course everybody decides to break off and deal with everybody else. Shikamaru deals with Anko. Let's see. Ten-Ten deals with the first proctor, the third exam. Rock Lee deals with the guy's lover. Yeah, it's a purple hair woman. I know exactly who she is. And, of course, they go to this tower, which is the same place that... which is a place where Naruto and Sasuke have the big battle. And this is also the place where you tend to see Sasuke get bitten by Orochimaru. Of course, you go into his cursed... mark form. Itachi is killed during all this, and they all like go away. Basically, of course, Naruto and Sasuke have the big battle, and pretty much it goes pretty much the same way it does in the regular reality. And Sasuke's headband falls up, but instead of Naruto keeping it, Orochimaru picks up and takes it with him. Yep. And because they failed, they get so. Pretty much since they failed, they head back to... So Naruto, Shikamaru, and Team Guy head back to Hidden Leaf Village. When they get there, apparently the Hidden Leaf Village is gone. And they look up, and there's the reason why. Because Pain has launched his attack in the Hidden Leaf Village, though it's done differently this time. Instead of basically destroying it with his almighty push, he pretty much lifts the whole thing up in the sky. Yeah, he pretty much does the thing where he did with Naruto in the regular thing. Except he does it with the entire Leaf Village lifted up in the sky. And pretty much the battle goes mostly the same way it does in the regular reality. I should also mention that Naruto goes under his Sage training during the 3-year jump. Excuse me. Instead of after Jiraiya's death in this reality. And of course, Jiraiya himself never dies. Yep. So, pretty much the battle goes similarly the same way. Some of the animation is like, when you watch this, like, after you watch season 8, it's like, kind of seeing deja vu. It's like, similar stuff, like, of course, also Hinata get taken out by Pain. Though this time, she has not confessed her feelings for Naruto this time. Saying that she's in love with him. I think she was supposed to say, like, he's my... I don't know if she was going to say comrade or beloved. I have no idea exactly what she was supposed to say. If somehow in this reality that Naruto and Hinata were a couple, I would have been surprised about that. It would have been nice. So, Naruto defeats all the Pains, And he goes to confront the real Pain, and he tells him the truth about what happened at Village, that it was not him, it was somebody else. And, of course, also, it was during this battle that, unlike in the regular reality, where, and of course, instead of basically him going to Sage mode, when he was prevented from going to his full tail beast form, when he's in that red form, this time, something different happens. So, Naruto's mother transfers the chakra from her half of Kurama into himself to create his tail beast chakra form. So it's a little bit earlier than expected. And he does defeat Pain. I had to bring that up. But basically, yeah, it's kind of the same thing, but it's different. And Pain and Nagato does release the Hidden Leaf Village. This time, instead of dying during Ryan Rebirth, because no one actually officially died. And of course, Naruto wants to join Team Jiraiya. But he has to deal some stuff in the village, like bring back Sasuke. So, after that, they go and confront... I think after that, they confront... let's see. I'm trying to think here. Yeah. Yeah, and of course, after Pain gets defeated, Sasuke kills Orochimaru, just like he does in regular reality. I should point out that the reason why, and Naruto has a reason for going to his tail beast form, because Hinata got hurt, and he was worried about her, and he wanted more power to defeat Pain. So, pretty much like right after he gets... Instead of having six rods, but this time it's only one. That's when Hinata comes in. And apparently the reason why she and Sakura were out of the village, apparently they were on a mission. So that's the reason why they weren't inside that giant moon of thing. And of course, Sakura heals Hinata like right after Naruto goes after Pain. Just like how she does in the regular reality. And then of course, Sasuke of course wants to destroy the Hidden Leaf Village. And instead of like regularly succumbing to like Rafter goes out, gets his team, basically he gets poisoned. Though he does survive, and of course Hinata tells everybody that Orochimaru's been killed, and what else? Yeah. So they go out and take out for Sasuke, and they run to the Akatsuki, and pretty much all of them get taken out pretty quickly. So we get sort of a bridge version of the Fourth Great Ninja War, though something different happens this time. Somehow Sasori captures and kills the Razakage, and the Mazakage turns them into human puppets, and of course they get destroyed. And Sasori gets pretty much defeated almost the same way he does in the regular reality. And he gets defeated by Naruto. But pretty much he gets defeated by Team 7. And then right after this battle, Naruto and Sasuke have their big battle, have the rematch. Not in Final Valley this time. Pretty much it's at the same place before, but this time it's different. And of course, in this battle also, this is when Naruto goes into his tail beast form, which is the same kind of the same thing he does in regular reality. And of course, the thing ends quite nicely. Everybody just going back and... Yeah. Yeah, everybody goes back and... they kind of ends there. And of course, it's revealed that because Tsunade was under a jutsu, they reveal that apparently in her reality, her lover and her brother are alive. Basically, Dan Kato was alive, he's Hokage, and her brother's alive, Orochimaru never left the village. Yep. It's a nice little 19-parter. But, of course, also they later on show everybody else's fantasy, like Hinata being with Naruto and Neji watching, which that kind of does happen in the regular reality later on. Gaara, I love his, where apparently the habit where in his fantasy, Gaara and Naruto have been friends since they were kids. Cool. Chikahamaru's was strange, because apparently in his one, Ashima and his father are still alive, of course. I should point out also that his father and Ino's father were taken out by Mandarachia's, the tail beast and his red bullets. So they're taken out, and of course they get all their last message. And I should also point this out also that Shikahama's father tells about, like, don't tell your mother about that that room in my closet. It's like about that box full of stuff that I don't want your mother to get your hands on. And Shikahama's like, yeah, I already know about it, and don't worry, I won't tell mom. Yeah, what was kept in that box? Playboy magazines or something else like that? It was so really bizarre. I just thought that was so funny. And then Shikahama, it was with Tamaru in this jutsu, and he's like, marriage, pass. And Tamaru's like, grow up. And of course they walk away. Kiba's I don't really care for. His is just, okay, he becomes Hokage, declares dog day, and wants everyone in the village to get a dog. Shino apparently discovers some new species of bug. Konkuru is some superhero. I think that's it. Yeah, I think that's it for the Otherwise Jutsu. Excuse me. After they wrap up the Dryas Scrolls thing, then of course comes, excuse me, Itachi's Memories, which this one is based upon one of the light novels. It's simply put, basically kind of what Itachi was up to prior to the clan massacre. It's basically his life. Up until you see him for the first time in the first series. Like, details, like, shows off, like, what he was up to, like when he was young, when he went to his ninja academy, Sasuke's birth, also him basically having sort of a girlfriend when he was much younger, and what else? Him having his own, and him graduating at the age of 9, and then like 2 years after that, he joins the Alba Black Ops, and because of all his missions, stuff like that. I mean, it's nice the fact he has a cute little girlfriend, and of course, there's a little bit of Sasuke during all this, because the only reason why we're experiencing, in the story, it's shown the reason why everybody is seeing all Itachi's memories, because Sasuke has Itachi's eyes. So apparently his memory is attached to it as well. So, and they show pretty much everything. They even show almost the full night of Itachi doing the massacre in gruesome detail. And apparently, even though that Obito, who was supposedly his marriage, he said that Itachi killed his lover, it was not Itachi who killed her. It was Obito. And Obito never told him. Well, not that I know of anyways. And he's the one who basically massacred everybody in the PlayStation. While he killed pretty much everybody else except for Sasuke. And of course we see some stuff we already seen. And we also get a chance to see Hazon get recruited into... You see Hazon and Data when they get recruited into the Akatsuki. We also get a chance to see the death of the fourth Masaragi. Like, see how he died and how his tail beast went off on his own. So basically, you can see stuff like of course, also his early stuff with the Akatsuki. And the thing ends with, even though the last one's a canon episode, the thing ends with basically kind of a montage of everything up until his death and, of course, his reanimation jutsu. And, of course, because the moon was under, like, shining everywhere, like, if Team 7 was caught in it, and Naruto tries to leave it, and everyone has to stay inside of Sasuke's like purple warrior. I think it's Shinzo, I think it's called. I'm not sure the name of it. And of course, when the thing stops, and then pretty much like right after that, Black Zazu betrays Mandra and basically brings back the real antagonist of this whole entire thing. Basically, it's the woman who got sealed up, or shown in flashback, sealed. Basically, it's a Sage of Six Paths mother. And she's a Byakugan user. Yep, she's a Byakugan user. So, she gets freed, and they spend pretty much a good chunk of the season pretty much just battling her in various different ways. In various different areas, like go different dimensions, like one is a desert, one is a heavy gravity place. This was also the heavy gravity places where Obito finally dies, and he also gives Kakashi both of the Sharingan eyes. And this goes on for a while, this whole big battle, and though I keep wondering, though, why doesn't Naruto tell her that she's not the only Byakugan user that he knows? For some reason. And I gotta admit, for some reason, that the woman is quite stunning. And she doesn't talk very much. Basically, it's Black Zatsu talking the whole time. And they eventually do seal her after a long while. They do seal her. And of course, before Widow leaves, this is of course after they had just won. And of course, Mento telling Naruto, tell him happy birthday because, well, the war officially ends on Naruto's 17th birthday, but everybody's still under the jutsu. And because, well, Sasuke's Rasengan Eye and, of course, Naruto having the tail piece chakra inside of him, they can basically undo it. Nope, they don't. But I should point out, though, before Obito goes back to the afterlife, he tells Kakashi this, make Naruto the 7th Hokage, and you become the 6th Hokage. This is probably like his last request, and of course takes back the Sharingan eyes, and oh, and by the way, I should point this out, how this rabbit demon is defeated. Simply put, it's, well, Sakura basically being beamed, sort of like transported right behind her, giving her monster strength punch the back of this woman's head, and then, of course, Naruto and Sasuke seal her. So simply put, Team 7 defeats the rabbit demon. Yeah. Beats the woman, basically, who defeats the woman whose initials are K.O. Yep. And, like, they defeated, like, how are we going to get back now? So, basically, what the Sage Six Paths does, he not only has the four Reanimate Hokages, but he brings back all the previous Hokages. Pretty much anybody who leads these five villages brings them all into this big circle and transports Team 7 back to the regular Earth. And Sasuke is like, no, I'm not going to free everybody. Instead of like undoing the, like releasing the jutsu, he wants to kill all the Kages. So Naruto wants to stop him, so they go out to Final Valley to have their big, humongous rematch. And this rematch pretty much destroys Mandra, Chiya, and First Hokage's statue. This battle goes on for about four episodes. And they go into, like, their regular forms. And then at one point, they're almost out of chakra. And they're basically just beating the crap out of each other with basically no energy. And of course, during all this, like, because they had one of their attacks, Sasuke lost the little thing. He lost his belt and rope, and Naruto lost his coat. Yeah, he lost his coat, which already been shredded already. And then they had one last attack. Excuse me, the Jori and the Rasengan, and they fired each other, though this time actually ended differently. Because it was not some punch like it was last time. This time, when their attacks hit, they lost both of their arms. Not kidding. And then Saga comes in, heals both of their arms. I'm I I would have not been surprised that after they activate the reanimation, that I was kind of expecting, because of this big, huge battle, instead of, like, undoing the reanimation jutsu right away, instead they decided to fight each other, and of course they lost both, they lost their arms. So the way their arms are lost is quite strange. Basically, they're lost at the elbow. Like, this part of their arm is lost. Basically, both of them lost their left arms. And even though they were still able to undo the jutsu, because they both formed the separate hand signs with their only remaining arms, and everybody got freed. And one thing I was kind of hoping to happen, because I'm sure Sakura was very mad at both of them for fighting and losing both their arms, I was kind of expecting her to either knock them both in the head, like, take her fist and knock them both in the head, or slap both of them. But nope, didn't happen. And of course, because Reanimated Jutsu is free, everybody goes home, war is over, Naruto is an international celebrity, and he gets sort of recommended to be promoted to Chunin, but because he didn't take the Chunin exams, he has to study for the next 2 years. Of course, also in the last episode, we also get a chance to see Gorin. First time since season 6 we've seen this woman. And everybody wants to see Naruto so badly. And it's a pretty nice ending to it. And the way this episode ends, it kind of feels like the series is over, but of course later we had the last, basically, which took place 2 years after the season. And prior to this also, Kakashi was made the new Hokage, with the fifth Hokage retiring. So, yeah. That is it for season 20. Overall, 20 was a pretty good season overall. Not really any bad episode. Despite it being a long season, there was no bad episode. Despite the fact some hiccups here and there, and being a long season, it will take you a while to get through it. Because I marathoned this whole thing, it took me almost a month to finish up both series, though 21 is still going on right now, and I will talk about that in my next part. But, yeah, that's it for this part. Next part will be in part 12. I'll talk about season 21. My friend Edgar and I are going to do a short review of the film The Last. Basically, that'll be done with a special. As when I'm going to do part 12, I probably will do it tomorrow. And I'll get my thoughts on the current season. But 19 was a pretty good season. 20 was a really good season. Okay? But, yeah, that's it. So until then, I will see you there. Bye.